Darren Millard coming to you from the new home office of the Chirp with Darren Millard here in Las Vegas, Nevada. Things coming together right now. Next week, things in this office should be finished as we transition floors from the second down to the first, and we might even show it off a little bit. But first, some more sound baffling has to arrive and get put up. Admission out of the gate. Just before we get too far into this episode, I love being able to say the Stanley Cup semifinal and not face any repercussions from a boss or those in charge. I know that we're only allowed to say it for this year because of COVID and because of the playing with the traditional conferences, but it just feels and it sounds right. Stanley Cup semifinals. Teams that win the West and the East in a normal year, even this year, you deserve a trophy for winning a third round and getting through a third round in a conference final. And marketing and historical references, they need that conference final column in the NHL record book and guide. But Stanley Cup semifinal, there's something a little more dramatic about it. And I've said it as much as I can say it through radio and this podcast and different platforms that I've been on. So just for one more time, I hope you've enjoyed the Stanley Cup semifinals. Today, we connect with Rod Brind'Amour, an award-winning player, a Stanley Cup champion as an athlete, and now he is the NHL's Coach of the Year. He has a new contract in his back pocket. He has fresh respect around the hockey world, along with what he's built up over the course of his decades around the professional game. But what remains at the forefront is his passion. And we're going to cover a lot during our conversation with Rod, but we kick it off with family and talk about Carolina's number one hockey fan. Here's Rod Brind'Amour on The Chirp with Darren Millard. Before we get too deep into this, how's dad?
Good. He's good. He's good. You're talking about my dad, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, he's good. He's bummed out that he's, you know, we're out, but he's good. Thank you for asking.
So what was his reaction to the Jack Adams?
Well, it was all him, right? It was all him. So everything he'd ever taught me came out, you know, just it was all about him. So it was good. You know, he's the biggest hockey fan ever. So yeah, any little positive thing that can happen our way is great. So he's enjoying life watching hockey, that's for sure.
So where does his love for the game come from?
Good question. He played back in the day. I mean, he was a good little player. You know, I hear the stories about how he had to, you know, strap the magazines on and, you know, all that stuff and walk to the rink. But it was actually true, you know. So, but I think just growing up in Canada, like, you know how it is. I mean, it was that's all you kind of thought about. And then he coached me when I was younger. So just being involved all the time. And he's really never left. So he's always been around and big part of my life, obviously.
What kind of coach was he?
You know what? Looking back on it was very good, shockingly. Like, I mean, you know, I tell a quick story if you don't want mine.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, I was Bantam age. Okay. That's that critical age, right? I think that's the most important age you want to coach because you have a lot of influence on everything. And we're a small town, Campbell River, British Columbia. I don't even think we have 15 kids that can play. Like, so we're bare bones. He comes home and he's the head coach. He says, you're playing defense. And I was like, what do you mean I'm playing defense? How am I going to be like Wayne Gretzky? You know, the whole thing of no chance of playing defense. And so I go up to my mom and start, you know, complaining. My mom's like neutral as ever. So, of course, my dad said, look, you're playing D. We have nobody that can play D. We're only going to dress four defensemen. You're going to play half the game. Shut up. This is going to be better for you. And so for 2 years, I played defense. And I'm telling you, it was the best thing ever because it opened my eyes to the game, you know, how to get open. Is that if I'm a defenseman, where's that centerman need to be so he can get the all these little things that, you know, I think helped me later in life was because I got to play D. And obviously it was only because we didn't have the numbers, but, you know, there were little things like that. I think I look back on made a big difference.
Okay. I got to ask, you played the mom card? Seriously?
Oh yeah. Always. I always played the mom card. My dad was a tough guy, right? Like, you know, never really, you know, my mom, oh, you're gonna, I'm gonna tell dad when I get home, you know, all that stuff. And then every occasionally, if my dad got mad, it was just, I just knew to run outside. We were just joking about this the other day, like just be gone for 20 minutes, let him cool off, you know, and then we were good.
Do you think that that being able to see the eye through the eyes of a defenseman helps you as a coach, not just as a player when you played?
Oh, well, I don't know anymore now. Like, I think for sure as a player growing up at that age, because then obviously I started playing forward again, totally changed my the way to think of the game. And maybe, you know, like I always thought the defense was the easiest position to create offense from because nobody's checking you, you know, like they would always lose sight of you. And now you just go up the ice and come back and I'm like, nobody's on me. This is great. So I don't know if it's changed how I think at all, but you know, that like I said, at that age, impressionable age, like coaches, I get coach credit for being coaching. I'm coaching NHL hockey players. How hard is it? You know, when you, the hard age is when they're at that 14, 15 stage where you got to teach them what they're going to carry on. They are who they are. Like that's important. So I don't think our young coaches get enough credit for what they do with the stars of the game. Cause go back a few years and see who was influencing them. That's what we probably could do better. And you'd be surprised at what you come up with.
Who put you back on forward?
Well, then I went to Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. And then I can talk about coaches. Again, do your homework on this one. Go back and see how many Barry McKenzie, how many kids he influenced over his lifetime. Shocking. You'll blow your mind. And you just go, he played even for a year. You know, he coached that guy. There's hundreds of kids that either went to play, you know, in other levels, but in NHL too. And you know, we're good players. Like that, again, that age, that influence is huge.
So your dad had that real formative knowledge and influence on you. And then Barry, who's the best or closest players coach that you ever played for?
Oh, well, that's a good question. I mean, they've all been great. I think I go back to my first coach, second coach in Philadelphia. I had Paul Holmgren when I first got there, real stern, and I love him. I love him. And I love him because he gave me an opportunity. So, you know, I got to, you know, see, is he a player's coach? I'm not sure, you know, but the guy that came after, yeah, he still could. And the guy that came after him, Bill Dineen, you want to see a player's coach. I mean, you couldn't have a nicer guy be at the helm of a team. Like, I mean, we weren't very good then. It was just pre-Lindros kind of coming in at the same time. But he treated you like he was one of your kids. And he had a kid on the team. Like Kevin Dineen was there. So it was really weird dynamic, but we were all his kids, you know? And that's kind of how we felt it. So that was probably the best player's coach because he never gave you grief, you know, at anything. It's probably his downfall maybe because he was too nice to us. But that guy was something special.
So are you a player's coach or not?
I don't know. You have to ask the guys. I mean, I think I am only because now it's changed. And I think, you know, I definitely always prepare and think of what I would want to hear if I was sitting in the seat in that locker room from the coach. So as I speak it, I feel like, you know, that's kind of where I know. I still kind of see myself as a player. I'm not a player, but I think like that. Like, I know I don't talk probably the coach talk the same. I'm just a little more, I try to just be myself. And I still, like I said, I still kind of, I think gravitate more to the players than the actual coaches, if that makes any sense.
Totally does. So when you go in to speak to your players, and we're fortunate enough to see some of that through the Carolina Hurricanes, do you consciously go, what do these guys want to hear from the coach, or
is it just natural? Well, first of all, you know, and I know it's good for TV, and I think it's good for hockey to have the cameras in there. I mean, I love it when other sports do it. I don't like it when it's in mine because I find myself kind of being careful sometimes, you know, like, oh, I better not say something that gets misconstrued and then I'm in trouble, right? Like, so it's in the back of my mind when I see a camera come behind me. So I don't like it for that reason. But mostly it's how I think. So I don't really have to think how, you know, when I said I have to think of what they would want to hear from me, it's more, I feel like I'm already in their shoes. I know how they feel after getting, you know, losing in a playoff game when they had the game won, because I've been there. Like, I know exactly what you're thinking right now. And I think that's where it kind of helps me from doing it before.
Did you want to coach, or did you start coaching because it was a way to stay in the game?
Yeah, that's a great question. I did not want to coach. So when I got done, you know, with it, I was happy. The grind was over in my mind, and took a year off, and I just did player development, and it was the best job ever. And then I got back in, and I actually had the best job ever, which was I was assistant coach, but I didn't have to travel. So I was at every home practice, every game, but when they went on the road, I'm coaching my son, right? Like I don't know why I got away from that. Like I had the best gig ever. And then it gradually, you know, I didn't have any influence though. Like you can't be a part-time coach and put something in, you know what I mean? You're just basically helping and you're helping. And for, you know, a few years I did that. And then I just got the kind of opportunity to say, look, we want to take on a little bigger role. And, you know, then one thing leads to another and here I am. But what I love about the job I do now is we're kind of all inclusive. So I'm coaching, but we're involved in the draft and we're involved in the pro scouting, and it's a lot of work because it never really ends, but we're doing everything. And I like having your hands on kind of everything going on.
Do you think you have more influence than 29, 28 other coaches?
I don't know what their situations are. You know, I don't know what they'd want that. Like, you know, just focus on coaching and maybe that's what I should be doing. But I still think I enjoy that. I enjoy being like, I don't get much involved in the draft, but I'll watch the first round kids and I'll like, hey, where are we picking? And I'll tell the guy, he'll give me Daren York's grade. He'll give me video of the 10 or so guys in that range. And then boom, you know, I'm at it. And then I'll get my opinions. And then it's fun to, when we're at the draft table, I know, kind of have a clue what's going on. Like I know some of these kids, I've been around it a little bit. And then obviously the pro side is way different. That's where I have a lot more influence, but I don't know if it's good or bad. I just know that's how we're doing it here. And I like it.
What's Donnie been like to work with? Because you guys kind of almost didn't make it up as you were going along, but it evolved, right?
Yeah, he's great. And that's another huge reason why I love it here. He's just a nice dude and we get along great. And, you know, I know he gives me the yes, yes all the time when I'm talking. I know he's going in the back of his mind, this isn't going to happen, but he lets me vent like that. And we talk about every possible thing. And I kind of, like I say, it's a good relationship. He's been great for us. He's been great for our owner, because I think Tom is very, very, man, he is hands-on on everything. He's got to be the hardest working man in sports. Like he'll call you about the draft. He'll call you about a player. He'll call someone that knows him about a player. Like he's involved in everything and he watches stuff now. He's learned on the fly. So it's an interesting dynamic, but Donnie is in the middle of it all. Right. And so he's really been great for us.
How often do you talk to Tom?
Well, it's probably, if it's not every day, it's every other day. And it would be every day if you picked up the phone every time you call. Like we have a little system. He knows, like he calls, if I don't answer and he doesn't really have something important, he doesn't say, call me back. He just goes on to the next guy on the list, you know, but if it's important, he'll say, call me back. So then, all right, I give him a call. But he's, like I say, he's 100% in on trying to win. And that's pretty cool too.
So what makes it work with him being so intense and you're intense? How does that?
I think it's, we're on the same page, like trying to get better. And he's got, you know, he's way more analytical than I am. So I'm learning that. And I'm not saying I'm resistant to it. I'm just still waiting for, see the results from it. Like, you know, so we're always kind of this battle back and forth, but I think it works. Donnie's in the middle, like I said, so he's kind of this buffer, I think, that just kind of calms everybody down. And that's why it's worked, I think, at least these few years anyway.
Okay, give me a what's it like when the phone rings and it's Tom and you look at it and you I'm not gonna take it. Do you kind of look around to see if he's like looking over your shoulder?
It doesn't work like that. It's if I see it's Tom and I know I've got, you know, I'm picking up my son from school in the carpool line in 2 minutes, I can't pick it up because it's not going to be a 2 minute conversation. So then I let it go. If I know I got to talk, I grab it, I'll pick it up. But, and then again, if it's not, call me back, I'm good. He's just trying to vent on something and doesn't really care if I answer or not. You know, if it's call me back, I gotta make time.
So do you like coaching?
I like it. I like it because of the group I have. I know every coach says that because you have to. Right. But it's really a special group. And so every day I come, I enjoy being around the guys. Maybe it's still that player mentality that I have. Like I really enjoy the atmosphere and the way our guys are and their attitudes. And, And that's great. What I hate about coaching, and that's why I doubt I'll be doing this like very long. I don't know how long, like 2-3 years. Is it going to be 5? Who knows? But it's man, you win, you're supposed to win. So you're good. But every time you lose, it's like you were supposed to win. And so you never really, there's no real enjoyment out of it. If that makes any sense. Like, it's like, okay, what am I getting out of this? I'm supposed to be winning. Like, we're supposed to win the whole thing or whatever every night. And that's impossible, right? It doesn't happen. So there's never really that high until I guess you would win it all. And that's why we're, you know, there's that, still that carrot out there. You want to be the best team. And that's obviously what we're still trying to accomplish.
So you wouldn't be a coach if it wasn't Carolina, right? Am I reading
that?
It'd
be really hard.
Yeah.
I think it'd be hard. It'd be hard because, you know, part of what I preach is that how much you care about your play. Like, you know, there's that. And because I believe it and the guys know I believe it, I think that helps my message. If I went somewhere else and said, okay, we got it. And when I don't even know the history, I don't know the blood, sweat, and tears that's put into this crest. Like, what are you talking about? And, you know, it doesn't make any sense. That's phony. And I don't think that would work. Now, can you learn that? Sure. You have to. All these coaches do it great everywhere. And I'm sure that would be fine. It just right now, it certainly doesn't seem like something I would be good at.
There was a point where I was doing a Hockey Night in Canada game and sidelines, and it was in Ottawa and you guys were playing there and it was late in the season. Eric Carlson was still there. And I was still there. So that's a while ago. And you came out and you were assistant coach with Bill. And I don't think I've ever seen a guy as intense as you were, as you came down the tunnel and then into the room. Is it like that every night with you?
Well, if I was an assistant coach, I probably just got reamed out by Bill because the power play wasn't working. So I was probably just mad as ever. That's probably what happened on that one. You know, I don't know. I mean, there's a high expectation here and it's real. It's not phony. Like it's different if your team's not good and you expect too much out of a group, then how can you really be upset if they're not doing, but if you have the right group and they're not performing, that's on me. That's my job. So that's probably where you get that, you know, if I'm steaming, it's because we're not playing right. And who's that fall on, right? That's on me. So I don't know. I mean, I guess you caught me on an interesting day, maybe.
I just found it fascinating because not often, and don't take this the wrong way, but not often you're looking at the assistant coaches. You're usually looking for the head coach to see what that reaction is. And that kind of grabbed and jumped out at me.
Had to have been. I was running the power play and Billy gave me the look down there like, this is all on you. And, you know, now I knew I was in for a tough night. So,
are you an X and O guy at all?
I hate to say that I'm X and O's. I think I'm detailed for sure. Like we got to do details, but I really try to not be, think it's 100%. You have to do it this way or that way. I mean, I hated that as a player. You got to let the guys play, right? Like, you know, you can go off script if you get it, if you do it right. Like if I'm supposed to be here, but I read that this D is going D to D and I jump the pass, you better get it.
Yeah.
Right. Like I'm okay with it, but you know, and so I want the guys to know they can make plays. But we're dialed in. We got to have the, you know, it's all about details nowadays. Everybody's so sharp with stuff. Like if you're loosey goosey, you're going to be in trouble.
When you look at your playing career now as a coach, are you a better coach than you were a player, or were you a better player than you are a coach?
Oh man, I would hope I'd say I was a better player.
You're Jack Adams winner though.
Yeah, that makes it tough, right? But the Jack Adams Award, like I think I'm pumped. I'm glad that we got it, but it's such a like a team thing. Like, right? I mean, if there's one award that actually, when you say that, it's team award, you can't be the coach of the year without great people around you. And let's face it, you better have the horses on the bus when you get going. Otherwise you have no chance to win this award. Right. So I got a good team. And then I think the best staff from around, like they're dialed in on everything. So I don't have to micromanage everything. Like that would be impossible. So it's, you're in charge of that. You're in charge of this. We got the best strength coach. I don't even worry about that. We're getting covered there, you know? So when I feel like you got all that covered off, like I think I said in one of the interviews, like, the question was, did you win that Jack Adams Award? It was more like, how do you not win it if you have all these pieces around you, you know, like really? So I'm pretty fortunate that way. So I don't know if I'm a better coach or not. I think that'll be, time will tell, right? Because you know how quickly this stuff turns around.
You know what impresses me, and I'm happiest about your Jack Adams Award, is that so often it's the most improved team or the coach that just takes over and wins it and does that big jump. But you guys were expected to do well this year. You did well, and you won it. Does that make sense to you at all?
Yeah, I think it does. I mean, I know all these awards get, I guess, voted on like at the end of the season. Like, it's a weird award to say coach of the year when it should be just, it really should be stated coach of the regular season, mm-hmm. because that is a big deal, by the way. Like, I do think there's two different seasons, and I think to get through a 56 game, but jammed in an 82 game season and do it right for that long length of time should get some sort of like recognition, because that is special. But it seems awkward that, you know, you get coach of the year and there's four teams still playing or whatever, right? Like, it's like, well, like, you didn't do that good a job. So, but there's almost two different years. So, anyway, I don't know if that makes sense, but it's an honor for sure. And, you know, I'm not going to discount it.
Where does the trophy go in your house?
I don't even know if you get a trophy, do you?
Yeah.
I mean, I missed out. I joked with my family because, you know, back in the day, I did get two Selke awards, yeah. And it was like a big awards show. You know, so we got dressed up. I brought my kid. It was an awesome experience. Like, and now we're doing it on Zoom, and it's like nobody really, like, whatever, right? It's just, I'm like, of all the years to win it, we could have waited till we got through this and had an actual celebration, right? But I don't know where it'll go. Who knows? It'll get put somewhere, I'm sure.
Where are the Selkies?
Well, this is a funny story. So I've lived here forever, and I finally sold. I had a house. I've got four kids, but three are gone now. So I needed to downsize, and we had this way too big a house. So we sold it mid-season, and then wasn't 100% sure how things were going to work out, right? Like, I mean, so I wasn't just going to – so we were in this temporary home where all the boxes are in the garage and just jacked up. So we're now like, okay, we know we're going to be here, and I don't know where anything is, to be honest with you. So we're in the middle of unpacking right now.
So you really didn't know that you were going to be there long-term? It was in the air?
It was up in the air and right to the last minute in some ways, right? Like, I knew that if we could get the people around me figured out that my deal was done, but it was, you know, scratching and clawing there just to make sure we could get everybody happy. And for the most part, we did that. So easy decision.
I don't want to talk too deep in it, but I heard that you were holding out so everybody else got paid. Is that true?
Well, it wasn't so much paid because, listen, the one thing I respect about Tom Dundon, our owner, is that from day one, he says, I'm going to pay the players. I'm going to give you the best chance to win as a coach. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, you know how I want a fair fight. Like, for 20 years I played, or 10 years I was playing, it wasn't a fair fight, except for 1 year. Mm-hmm. And the 1 year was out of the lockout when they, you know, everyone had this thing. And what happened? Hurricanes won the Stanley Cup. Okay, so all those other years and the years prior, like, it became not a fair fight. We line up against a team that's got $20 million more in payroll or whatever. It's just not a fair fight, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Never gets talked about, but as a player, you're like, oh, like, come on. I mean, you know, you get it. So now Tom comes in and says, we're going to have a fair fight. Really? Now, I'm not going to pay staff and this and that what everyone else is making, because that doesn't make sense in our market. And to me, he's dead on. You know, you're going to work this job, and if you want it and be part of it, that's great, but I can't pay you what they're paying over here because we're the sixth lowest revenue team in the league, blah blah blah. It makes sense to me, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Now, there's other ways that he makes it up, and he does, and that's kind of where this question came up. I just wanted my people around that I can trust and build this, because they're my family. I mean, they just are. I've been around these people forever. And so we had to make sure that they were happy, not necessarily taken care of financially, because I don't know. You're always comparing yourself to the Joe down the road, right? And it's just not quite the way you have to do it. But once I felt like we were all fairly taken care of, then I thought, okay, now easy. Let's get my deal done, and we're ready to go.
Tell me about some of the guys on your staff, some of the people on your staff.
Well, Jeff Daniels is most underrated assistant coach ever. And he's been here longer than I have. So as a player, I played with him. And then he coached in the minors. He was head coach in Charlotte for the Checkers. And then he became a pro scout. He's been around hockey his whole life. And he is phenomenal at dealing with people, like one-on-one, right? Just quietest ever guy you're going to meet, but it's all up here. And so when he gets with our young players, especially, we got a lot of young forwards, he works great with them, great with me on the bench. We had a good thing going there. And then I brought in Dean Chanel, who again works with the D. He's had the exact same kind of experiences, you know? So we click. And so that's good. And then the ace in the hole for us is our pre-scout, is our video guy. And that's Chris Huffine. And he's been around for 25 years. He's been through all the coaches that came through here. So, he doesn't miss anything. Like, I've been doing this for 3 years. There's not been one thing I've been surprised by the other team. Now we get burned by stuff, but it wasn't that because we didn't tell the guys, or he didn't tell me beforehand that maybe you might want to show this or talk about this. Like, not one time, because he's on it. And so, like, that's why I go back to, how do you not win that award? When you have all that people around you that are just, here's the help, just get out of the way. Like, just stay in your lane and go, you know? Like, I feel like that's what I got. And then I have this great strength coach who just helps build the culture around here, a guy named Bill Bernstein. And so it just works, you know. And our trainers have been around forever. Bob Gorman, Skip Cunningham just retired. I mean, these guys were around when Gordie Howe was in our locker room. You know, like, how do you not have success when you have that kind of experience around? You know, like, it's just, there's a lot of good things that can really help you when you need it. Let's put it that way.
What was the last workout you did?
The last one? Well, that was this morning. I mean, I'm in there every day, you know, and what I love about it too, we talk about ownership. He built us finally a new practice facility. Like, that was the one thing we just didn't have down here. Now Tom says, what do you need? What do the players need? Yeah. Players need this. Here you go. Done. Like, that's it. Done. You know, like, that's pretty cool. And now we got guys that hang around here. And so they're in every day, and it's just, it's all positive stuff when it comes to that. So, you know, again, pretty special.
Do you still lift, or do you do more cardio now?
I'm on the executive workout plan for sure, you know, but you know, I still do the testing that we would do normally. Now the testing got gassed because, you know, whatever, the PA and the union, whatever, getting a little soft and making sure guys, you know, don't overdo it. But I still have that test stuff, and we you know, I still try to make sure I can hang in there, because I don't want to ask if something that, you know, hey, it's easy to, if I could still do the stuff, then how can a guy complain about it? Right now, again, now we can't do it. So it's more fun stuff that we do, but you know, I still try to stay in there.
What are you going to do for the summer then? Now that you've been on this wild, like, crazy season and a half.
I don't know. Like, we're getting ready for the draft. We got this free agency. We got 8 guys we have to sign that are, you know, potential free agents. And I mean, we're already dealing with that. And then you have the expansion draft, and, you know, so I don't think we're going to stop till probably August. We'll get a week or two and then figure it out, you know, if we want to take a little break.
Hey, would you like to play against Connor or Austin or some of these top offensive
Not
guys?
Now. No? Not now. But I tell you, I do always think, now that I've been doing this coaching thing for so long, I wish I had all this knowledge when I played, because when I played, they didn't have this, like, the video. You didn't really know what the other team was doing. You didn't really, you know, on the power play, have these little extra little things or know what they're doing, because the video and the coaching wasn't the same. You know, now I'm like, God, I only knew all this when I was a player, I would have been something special. But, you know, that's a joke. Obviously, these guys are so much better than even they were 10 years ago. You know, it's the athlete is phenomenal now. And, you know, and it's the same thing when I was going, the Billy Barbers of the day would say the same thing about us, you know, and when talking to them. And that's great. The game's evolving. It's getting better and better. And hopefully it just continues to keep doing that.
Any former coaches reach out to you when you won the Jack?
All of them, almost. Like, it's that's pretty special too, is your phone blowing up. And then you people you have, I mentioned Bill Barber. He didn't actually even coach me, but when I was in Philadelphia, took me under his wing. We became, like, he literally had me over his house all the time. I was a young kid at the time. And, you know, we'd ride Harleys together. He got me, get me on a motorbike, and just, we would take off and do things. And his family took me in at Christmases and stuff before I even had my family. So it's just, that was kind of how they did it there in Philadelphia. You know, they had that strong alumni group, and they took care of the young guys coming up. And we still stay in touch to this day. And, you know, just special group they had.
How many coaches did you play for?
Too many, right? Too many. I think when I counted it the one time, because I had this question, I had over 17, I think, head coaches at one time in 20 years. Now, I was counting like world championships and Olympics and when you start going around, but it was a ton of influence, you know, on me, and all great, right? I always say you take the good and the bad from all the coaches that help you, you know, kind of drive who you are, because you learn a lot from the ones that are no good, right? Mm-hmm. And there are a few that were like, well, I would never do that. And it's just, okay, no, let's ixnay that. We're not even going to go down that road. And so it all helps, I think.
Do you like the iPad on the bench?
No. I don't even know how to use it. First of all, that's probably why. Like, it's so frustrating. You're trying to get to it and then you're hitting the things and they don't go right and get it out of my face. But the guys always can look at it, and some guys like it, but it's always not an excuse, but it's always like, you know, there's always something there instead of just, I just screwed that up. I don't need to see it. I wish they would just, you know, do it that way, but that's how they learn now, right? They learn through the video. The kids all want to see that instant feedback. So if they're happy with it, then I'm good with it.
A player that you have right now that you just love to watch. And I know that's sort of unfair because you got to single out an athlete, but just in skill.
I'm lucky. I got a bunch of them. I do have a bunch of them, but like the Ahos of the world are special because I've seen him since he came to development camp after he got drafted. And I saw where he was, and now I see where he is, and all in between how he got there. That's special. Like, just to watch a kid figure it out on his own, saying, I'm going to do this. And then you say, okay, why is he figured it out? And you watch, cause he sat beside a Jordan Stahl all these years and just, okay. And, you know, and it, you can actually see it. You hear people talk about that, right? Like the importance of leadership and blah, blah, blah. Right. Yes. But when you see it grow like it has in this kid from watching someone every day do it right, it makes you feel good. You know, you're like, okay, we're on the right path here. You know, it does matter. And that kid just wants to win. That's it. Plain and simple. And now he's, you know, he's got his money, right? He's getting paid. So you take that out of the equation. He's more competitive than anybody I've been around. So that's pretty cool.
So you've won Selkies, you've won Jack Adams, you won a Stanley Cup. Are you cool at all to your kids?
Am I cool to them? I don't know. It's not a big deal, which is great. Yeah. Right. Like, I mean, my youngest guy never saw me play. Okay. So I got a 9-year-old and I'm coaching him now when I can in hockey. But he thinks I'm the best player ever. Whereas my oldest who plays hockey still in college hockey, he saw me play. He knows that's not true. Right. So it's actually kind of interesting where my youngest thinks I'm the best, but the older guys are like, yeah, we know what he was.
I don't get a chance to catch up with you often enough, but big fan and love how natural you are with your group and in the room, especially. Congratulations, well-deserved, and keep it going, pal.
Okay, Daren. Thanks, buddy. Have a good day.
You too. He's just a cool guy. I go back with Rod, not as friends or anything like that, but awareness of Rod Brind'Amour back to his time at Wilcox, Saskatchewan and Notre Dame as a member of the Hounds, because he was on the radar then. And then he went to college and we all know about Rod the Bod in Philadelphia and then his time as a Stanley Cup champion, a player with the Carolina Hurricanes. But I've known about Rod and followed him for so long. And then to see him the way he is now and not really change at all. He doesn't use that coach speak that we're so familiar with. And there's a time and a place and like that, but he's just true to himself in his personality. And that comes through. And to the point where did you notice when you were listening to him talk where he said he doesn't know if he's going to coach 2 years or 5 years? Well, what in the back of my mind, I'm like, he's got a 3-year contract, but maybe he'll only coach a couple of more years, but really cool. And the game's better. It's certainly better with having Rod Brind'Amour around and in some capacity. Maybe he'll go coach Bantam hockey and be part of those formative years, that key point that they talked about with his dad. So a lot of fun talking to Rod Brind'Amour and being around the National Hockey League's Coach of the Year. Also want to mention, if you like what you're hearing here, and you want a little more nuts and bolts of the Stanley Cup playoffs to talk about the Stanley Cup semifinals and then into the Stanley Cup championship series. The team over at NHL Productions at the Rink podcast with Dan and Sean, Dan Rosen, Sean Rourke, doing a great job there. Bob Bender also produces that podcast. So you know you're in good hands with the At the Rink guys. And it's just a really cool sound about the urgency of the Stanley Cup playoffs and what's going on in and around these games going through the Stanley Cup semifinals and into the championship series. Scotty Gomez was on talking about a guy that that we followed way back when. And now up, Scotty Gomez was on last week. So give them a follow, give them a listen. I do as well. So just we'll follow that little route through to the presentation of the Stanley Cup. 116 degrees, by the way. They played a game in Las Vegas in the Stanley Cup semifinals against Montreal. 116 degrees outside. Record-setting temperature for that particular day. And they played a hockey game. And it was fine. Ice was great. And so stick tap to the ice crew, everybody over at T-Mobile. Really cool that they can do that. Smash the like button. That's what I'm doing for the ice crew. Give us a follow. Give us a rate. If you love what you're listening to, give us your reaction to what Rod Brind'Amour had to say today and just his passion for the game and what you expect. Do you like to hear more of that from a coach instead of the X's and O's? Or do you think that it's just a one-off and maybe it's just like just part of who Rod is and that that will be standing separate from a lot of the other coaches that that we hear about. You know, Rod Brind'Amour, really cool. Scotty Bowman, he's been on at the rink in the past. Like Scotty Bowman, guys that just follow and have this passion for the game. Really cool. John Cooper, he's been on with us before with the Chirp podcast. They just ooze hockey. Thanks for listening. Really appreciate it. Again, subscribe, rate, review, all that stuff, and make sure that you pay attention for next week's episode as we work our way into the Stanley Cup final for 2021.